through me, and therefore all means were made available to make that come to pass, because of probably distant barriers, cultural barriers. So from wherever you are, by grace, I believe you can receive me from different dispensations. For that, I don't take this for granted. We've been sharing the scriptures, and we've walked the journey, and we've paid much attention on the person of the Holy Ghost. And today we want to begin something a bit different. Now that we have that understanding, how do we turn it for our good? And I'm calling my first leading from the book of Hebrews, chapter 4, verses 12 and 13. I'm taking from Amplified Version. The scripture says, "For the word that God speaks is alive and full of power, making it active, operative, energizing, and effective. It is sharper than any two-edged sword, penetrating to the dividing line of the breath of life, the soul, and the immortal spirit, and of joints and marrow, the deepest parts of our nature, exposing and sifting and analyzing and judging the very thoughts and the purposes of the heart." The common dilemma in the life of many Christians is, how do we bring that which is spoken to rhyme with my circumstances in life? The question many of his children are asking today is, can the word of the Lord be trusted? Is the word of the Lord relative or absolute? The question many of us must answer is on the efficacy of scriptures. The efficacy of scriptures. We have read from the book of Hebrews, chapter 4, verse 12, Paul speaking, he said, the word of the Lord, or the word that the Lord speaks, is alive and full of power. It's alive and full of power. Before we move on, let me just give an explanation that I know maybe will move some of us a little bit, but it's important to know the truth. The Bible is not the word of God. Now, before you respond, just listen. The Bible is a book that contains the word of God. On its own, in the bookshelf, it's not different from a historical book next to it. You got to understand that. What makes the word of the Lord in the Bible come alive is the transfer of the written to your spirit. I've seen many of us try things out of frustrations, where maybe you're praying over a matter and you're praising the Bible on top of whatever you're praying for. That may comfort your spirit, but it's just that. And for the next 20 minutes or so, we'll be sharing with us on a subject I'm calling Growing Up Unto God. How do we grow to benefit maximally from what the Lord has spoken? When you read from the scriptures we have read, the Bible is showing us something. It's saying the word of the Lord is sharper than any edged sword. What does that tell you? It has the ability to penetrate even where no one can go. It has that power to penetrate. It means, therefore, I can send the word on areas of life that my person in my natural me may not be able to get. It has the ability to go back to my past. It has the ability to add to my current. And it can travel to my future. The word is true. Is you must come to that point where you have known that the word of the Lord contains no error. That what God has said in his word as we read it is what he meant. Not what he meant. Jesus said something. Jesus said something when he was speaking. He said, to him that believe, all things are possible. What does all include? Everything minus nothing. But he said, all things are possible. He didn't say all things will be done. He said, all things are potentially able to come to pass to him that believes. When we move on, when we dip in, Paul speaking to the church of Galatians shows us who we are. Because our discussion must start there. Who are we? Who is a Christian? Galatians chapter 3, verse 26 and verse 29 says, for you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's seed. And if Abraham's seed, then heirs according to the promises. Shall we see that? It says, for all of us who have put on Christ, if any man be in Christ, that's what Christianity is. It says, we have been brought into the promises of God. We are sharers. But it says something. It says, For you are all sons. The Greek lettering for that name son is heos. Heos means born of, or you hail from. You hail from. It has to do with the source. It has nothing to do with the upbringing. It has everything to do with the source. It has nothing to do with state. It's not dealing with state. It's dealing with where can we trace you. It says our roots are traceable in God. And for that reason, because of Jesus Christ, we have been made heirs. Heirs of the word of the Lord. Heirs of the promise. So we have what we have. Ownership right. But we must understand that Christ's blood bought us. Which is different from being brought up. You are bought in. You must be brought up. You are bought in. Know that you are in, you are heirloom, you are from God, your journey has begun, your processes in God have just begun. So then, Bible says, Galatians chapter 4 verse 1 to 3, says, now I say that the heir, the child of God, as long as he's a child, does not differ at all from slave, though he is a master of all, but is under guardians, and they are the stewards until the time appointed for them by the Father. Even so, when we were children, we were embodied under the elements of the world. Now that you are sure that the promises of God are for us, because remember, we were not Jews. We had not broken the rule. So we were not under the curse. Because they that are under the curse are those who broke the law. But the Bible says in the book of Galatians that he, Christ, was made a curse for them. So that two things may happen. That they may be redeemed from the curse of the law. And we Gentiles may be brought in into the promises of God. We have now been brought in through Christ Jesus. Everything spoken in the scriptures is for you. Every promise therein is for you. It's for you. We have been brought in. So why are things then, if that be true, not working? What is the problem? Have you found yourself on a crossroad that the believed, if I may use that word, vis-a-vis the manifested, don't agree? So what do you need to do? If you read where we have read Galatians chapter 4, verse 1 to 3, he says, even so, verse 3, when we were children, he uses another term, a Greek word, he uses the word term nepios. Even so, when we were nepios, nepios are the untrained, the babes, the unskilled, what our English language would call the minor. And if you understand the ABCs of our role, you understand that minors don't sign any contract. It doesn't, you have been made a heir. You have sonship rights. It's yours. It could be a business. It could be a marriage. It could be whatever it is, your aspiration of your spirit, of your life. You are legally the owner, but you will need to grow to have what we call authorization rights. And that's what we are discussing today. Growing up into God. How do we grow up? How do we become? You see, when you are an nepio, what are the indicators? When you are nepios, what are the indicators? One, you are subject to diseases, although you carry the Zoe life of God in you. You are sick like anybody else, because the Bible says we are not, there is no separation. As long as you are an nepio, there is no separation. So whatever ails everyone ails you. And it becomes frustrating when you know by stripes you are healed, yet you are suffering. So is the healing spoken about true? And that's why you have found some people have gone to extent of trying to seek deliverance, trying to seek someone bless them, trying to make up with the elderly, which is okay. But I need to ask you, what is it that your grandmother will fix that Christ can't fix? What is it that your uncle will fix that Christ can't fix? If Papa God, Jesus Christ, can't bless your children, how is your uncle going to speak words of power over them and change their lives? You see, when you are a nepio, you walk in poverty, although the Bible says all things are yours. You live a life of defeat, although legally you are more than a conqueror. So you know that you are more than a conqueror, but everything in your life shows you are more than conquered. The manifestations in your life are speaking the opposite. It's when you are nepio, there is a mismatch between your words and your faith. You have the word in your heart, but the opinions in your mouth. This is why you hear people say, I know God is able. Not that I'm doubting God, but I simply don't know what is happening to my life. So you see, the scripture says, surely goodness and mercy follows us all the days, not some days. So then if that be true, then why is trouble following you all the days? Why is trouble following you all the days? Is it that you are facing a more devil, if I may use that term, than the one Christ was facing when he walked on the pavilions of this world? There is something he knew that you must know. Number one, until the Father manifested him, he was known as a son of the carpenter. Unless and until the Father has manifested you, you have no title. Although you are his son, you see, you have no title. Although you are his son, you have no title. There is lack of demonstration of power when you are an appeal. So you speak powerful things, demonstrate weak manifestations. All that there is in our lives when we are nepios is hope of what God has done and is able to do. But none of that is real in your life but you. Bible says in the book of Galatians, chapter 4, verse 4. Today we will pay much attention, probably from this letter, from this book. I believe it will give us some insight. One of the things that I need you to know in maturing in the things of God is, number one, is you will need to come to a place called fullness. Bible says, chapter 4, verse 4, verse 6. But when the fullness of time had come, there is element of time in every child of God. There are things in God that must be given time to grow. And one of them is your understanding of scriptures. You are not going to know everything about God by believing in Jesus Christ today. You will give yourself to study. You will give yourself to be cultured. Until the fullness comes, the Father will not manifest you. Because Papa God does not manifest that which he has not prepared. He does not. There is no soldier in this nation who has gone into war without going the training. No matter the level of emergency. We have our soldiers who are in another nation keeping peace. But we have others who are in training. Even if where the key peacekeepers are, there will be so much trouble. They that are in training, unless and until they have graduated, can't join them. There is the front line, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, that we aspire and we see others in the Lord be, which we cannot be paraded, however much we speak in tongues. Because there is a graduation taking place. There is a process. You see, but when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who are under the law, that we might receive the adoptions as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the spirit of his son into your heart, crying out, Abba Father. You are bought with a price. You see now, Paul is showing something else. He says now, but when the fullness was come, when the fullness of time was come, Paul says, Jesus was sent to redeem us. And then he says, verse 6, and because you are sons, he uses another word now, heroes. Who are sons? Who are heroes? One who is brought up. The brought up as daily exposure into understanding. You are brought up into daily understanding. One who has come of age in responsibility. One who's mastered this word. That no matter what you're going through, you have come to that place where your words don't depict what you're going through. Your words reflect your persona, which is captured by the word. There is such a tranquility, a calmness, when you are handling issues of life, when you are combating your enemy, the devil, there is a demonstration of dependability on the ability of our master. You see, Bible says in the book of Luke chapter 1 verse 18, and the child grew and waxed strong in spirit. We must work strong. Why do we need to work strong? Because unless you have worked strong and have acquired what I would call spiritual stamina, you cannot manifest. The devil doesn't want you grown up, because he knows when you are grown up, your spiritual stamina determines your degree of manifestation. The more you grow up, the much trouble you are to him. He would wish to have all of us congregate in our congregations and seek for life, seek for something out, seek for help from up there, seek for intervention. Bible says something, that first Adam was a living being. Second, last Adam was a life-giving spirit. And we are of the nature of second Adam, not first Adam. We are not life seekers. We are life givers. But we must come to that place. We must be grown up to that place. You see, when you have not grown up in stamina, in understanding scriptures, you have content without capacity. The problem of having content without capacity is that your character is fluid. No one can describe you. You are a force. God doesn't want you to be a force. He wants you to be one with force. That force is under your custody. So you know how to behave well. You see, I've come to understand as I grow up in the Lord that depending on the level of our positioning as a pastor, there are pastors to families, there are pastors to individuals, there are pastors to churches, there are pastors to legions, there are pastors to cities, there are pastors to countries, there are pastors to nations. And I must know where am I, so that I am not trying to address the nation when my capacity can only address a family. Because when I try to address the nation and my capacity handles a family, then there will be a lot of guesswork, because families are not the same. Families are not the same. So, my aspirations to see things move must not only be based on faith to move God, but on the question, how do I build my capacity in God? Understand this as a child of God. Growth is a personal responsibility. God is not responsible for your growth. You must understand that. It is your responsibility to pick up and learn. And Papa God has made available tools in his house. One of them is what? He's put his word in the Bible. Read the Bible for yourself. Understand. Understand the elements about prayer. Everything about prayer is in his book. Everything about faith is in book. Everything about healing is in his book. Everything about expansion, health, everything is in his book. Question should be, how then do I access? Refuse to be frustrated. You cannot be frustrated for being young. You must understand the cut line. Is what I'm facing a result of not knowing, or a result of an enemy? Am I going through this challenge because I need to know and grow up, or because an enemy is really opposing me? Because if it's not an enemy that is opposing you, you're going to cast, you're going to bind, you're going to overrule that which is imaginable. And all you need to do is grow. I have a daughter in the house, and she's knowing the things I'm doing. She knows the clothes her mama wears, and sometimes she admires the position of her mother. Sometimes she even accompanies her mother to her place of work, and there are protocols in the place of work, and she really misses sometimes the kind of respect her mother gets among her colleagues. But that's not something she can speak into her life in tongues. Before she was born, her mama was in school. She went through college. She carried her 9 months. Now that she has come and she has seen it, and she's seeing what is in the mother and where the mother is, then she must know the journey. She must have someone tell her the journey the mother has come. Why was it? Why? Think about it. Think about it. As much as urgent the salvation was, for me and you for 30 years. Jesus never attempted to deliver anyone. Think about it. Why was it necessary to be prepared for 30 years to handle a ministry of 3 years? It tells you simply that for everyone here, a decade. Everyone here, a decade. Think about John the Baptist. All his preparation for 6 months ministry only. You will not hurry God. Read from Genesis to Revelation. You see God walked. You will never see God run. He ain't gonna run because you're in trouble. Let the trouble you are in not deceive you that if he doesn't come quickly, it will take you out. For he has said in his word, he will never leave you nor forsake you. Desire to mature and to grow, and God has given elements without the devil dictating to your level of growth. Blessed be the name of Jesus. And what this does to us, brothers and sisters, is that it gives us an environment to really study our Papa and to really be brought up by him without feeling like we are losing out in life. Even if some of us may be ahead of us, even if they that probably be of the same age like us seem to be ahead of us, if I walk in the path my Father has prepared for me, because remember, you are running your own race. We are running our own race. I'm running my own race. That they went ahead of me doesn't mean that there's nothing for me if I arrive late. I am late according to their measure, not according to the measure Papa God has set for me. Because Bible does not demand from me to preach among Abraham's mates. Because Abraham had his generation. I have my generation. I must run my race. And for that reason, then my spirit is at peace. I've quieted my spirit. Like a child weaned in the hands of its mother, I've brought myself to that place, to that school, where the Spirit of the Lord is teaching me everything. And I am learning silently. Those who study personally, in 6 months, they are done. Those who are taking the courses of driving, in 1 month, they have their certificates. What about those who are studying medicine? 5 years, and they have never been allowed to any hospital to do an operation, but under supervision. You need to ask yourself, maybe, what is your assignment? And is it in tandem with the preparation that you are being taken through? Because I don't think God can prepare you for 10 years to build capacity to buy a house. That would be a waste of resources. We'll continue next time.